Morning. You may be seated as soon as you get back to your, place of business. I don't know. Some things just come right to your head, right? I don't know why I say what I say. But good morning. Welcome to Salem Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here on a rainy morning. I'm dried up now, but man, I got drenched just walking from one building to the other. So it's coming down out there. So I'm glad you didn't let that keep you away. Normally that's like a Baptist snowstorm is rain. So you guys are the hardcore people, buddy. Y'all are the hardcore folks. We're glad that you are here to worship with us. And if you are fifth or sixth grade and down, I hope you grabbed a guide to follow along with the service. I know we were out in the hallway, but there's still a few out in the lobby. So if you missed getting yours, you go ahead and grab that. We'll have the candy box at the end if you get to fill out a little of your front page there and be a part of our service this morning, because this service is for you just as much as it is for anybody else. So we're excited for you to be a part of our service with that. And if you would, as we continue this time of worship, do you mind to bow your heads and pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we are so absolutely thrilled to be here this morning, God, because we get to come here and worship the one true and living God who loved us and who saved us, Lord. We thank you for that, and we love you, and we just want you to know it through our singing, and we want to hear from you through your word, God. So I ask you to just bless this time that we have together. Be real in our hearts and let us hear from you, Lord. We love you so very much, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
That's where I want to be, near the cross, because that's where peace is and life and forgiveness and atonement and blessings and joy near the cross. It's unusual that an emblem of pain and suffering is used to bring us hope and joy. But it does, because God laid on him the iniquities of us all. And we are grateful for that cross. Amen. Just real quick, once again, I want to make mention to our display. We have begun our Sunday night Bible study on the armor of God. Tonight, we're going to be talking about the breastplate of righteousness. And so the second piece of our armor, thanks again to Angie and Pam for the display. And I hope you'll be with us tonight. Maybe you've not come on Sunday nights before. And we meet in the fellowship hall at 5 o'clock, and we'll have the coffee on and some good old high-carb cookies. And it's real laid back and just kind of a living room atmosphere, and we just study God's Word together. And we're understanding the armor of God so that we can be protected from the evil one, because he's alive and well out there, isn't he? But he who is in me is greater than he who is in the world. Amen? All right, enough for the mini sermon. Let's jump in. Take your Bibles and open with me to the book of Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 4. You got Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. And we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 4. Church, God tells us that we have an inner power, an inner influence, and that influencer is influencing our thoughts, our actions, our life, and this inner influence will always influence us to good. He always brings the best in our life. He takes us to the best. Jesus said, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. Well, this Spirit of truth is that inner influencer, and he is the Holy Spirit of God. For everyone who gets saved, for everyone who accepts Jesus Christ as their Savior, the Holy Spirit somehow, some way moves inside of our hearts. He lives inside of us. He lives in us to guide us and to guard us. We are the temple of God. We are the house that God lives in. What is God's address? It's your heart. And so God doesn't live in a building made with brick and mortar by the hands of men. God lives in us. We are the temple of God. And He lives in us through His Holy Spirit. His Holy Spirit is in us, and He is our inner influencer, and He's guiding and guarding our lives. However, even though every born-again Christian is the temple of God, even though every born-again Christian has the Holy Spirit living inside of them, not every believer is filled with the Spirit. Even though every believer is the temple of the Holy Spirit, not every believer is living under the direct influence of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, we're learning about the Holy Spirit. Through our Sunday morning message series, we're learning how to experience God's fullness in our life. Our message series is entitled Experiencing the Fullness of the Holy Spirit. And this is what we've learned so far. Corey has it on the screen for us. We've learned that He is the promised indwelling Holy Spirit. We've learned that He is the guiding Holy Spirit. We've learned that He's the guarding Holy Spirit. And today is number four. We're going to learn that He is the grieving Holy Spirit. Church, I think we oftentimes forget that the Holy Spirit is a person. He's alive. He is a person. And God, He is God. God is a living God. Therefore, the Holy Spirit is the person of the living God, and He lives inside of us. And because He's a person, He has feelings just like we do. The Holy Spirit, did you know that He has feelings? The Holy Spirit does. He has feelings like we do. As a matter of fact, we have feelings because He does. Because we're made in God's image. God can be happy just like we can be happy. God can be sad just like we can be sad. God can be mad just like we can be mad. But God can even have His feelings hurt, just like we can have our feelings. You ever had your feelings hurt before? We can have our feelings hurt because God can have His feelings hurt. And we're the ones that hurt His feelings. We've been singing about how glad we are for what He's done for us, but yet we're the ones that hurt His feelings. How do we hurt God's feelings? By grieving the Holy Spirit. Well, let's read what He says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. Very simple, straightforward, easy to understand. Paul says, "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." God's warning here is that we do not grieve His Holy Spirit who is living inside of us. He sent us the Spirit. He lives inside of us. We are not to grieve Him. Therefore, because of this warning, we understand that, yes, we can actually hurt God's feelings by grieving the Holy Spirit. So today we're going to learn, what does that mean? How do we, even though we're loved by God so much, how do we grieve Him? Well, church, the entire world can be classified into two groups. Did you know that? You can divide everybody into two groups. Smart people and Florida fans. Two groups, right? I'm kidding, Jojo. Actually, you can divide the world into four groups of people. Seriously, four groups of people. Everybody can be divided into these four groups. Corey's got it on the screen. You can be divided into the uninterested lost person. That's the person who is lost and they don't care. They're uninterested in the things of God. They're just living their life, leave them alone. The second group is the misguided lost person. They're ones that thinks they're saved, but they're not even really saved. And so when they stand before God, He's going to say, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you." Then there's number three, the carnal saved person. They're saved, but they're sinful. They have no fruit in their life. And then number four, there's the Spirit-filled saved person. That's the Christian who is filled with the Spirit. They're saved, they're faithful, and they're fruitful. Now, every person in this room can fit into one of these four categories. You can fit into one of these four categories right here. On this list right here, who do you suppose is the most miserable of those? Now, it's not the lost person. That may surprise you, because they're not miserable because they don't care or they don't know that they're lost. Now, one day, they will be the most miserable person because one day, they're going to be in hell. And let me just reassure you, everybody in hell is miserable. You don't want to go to hell. It's an awful place. So the lost person will be the most miserable, but they're not the most miserable now because they just don't know it yet. But on this list, as of today, right now, the most miserable person on that list is the third person, the carnal Christian, the saved but sinful person. It's the person who has the Holy Spirit living inside of them, but they're not influenced by the Holy Spirit. They're not following His guide. They're not heeding His guard. And instead of being led by the Spirit inside of them, they are bound by sin. Yes, they are saved. They made a genuine profession of faith. They were sincere when they asked Jesus Christ into their heart. But they've never given up their sinful tendencies. They still cling to sinful habits. They are struggling with reoccurring sin. They are held captive. They're in bondage by their sin. And because of it, they are miserable. They are miserable in their heart. They realize their sin is wrong. But their love for their sin is stronger than their hatred of grieving God. Why? Why is a carnal Christian so miserable? Because the Holy Spirit inside of them is grieved. He is grieving. God, the Spirit, is sad. And His feelings are hurt. God is unhappy inside of them. It's merely a one-sided love affair between them and God. God loves them. God lives inside of them. But the sinful saved person loves the world and their sin more than they love God inside of them. And because of it, God is grieved. And it makes them miserable. They are saved. But because the Holy Spirit is grieved, they are miserable on the inside. They're unhappy with themselves. They're dissatisfied with their life. They're full of remorse and regret. Oh, they may be smiling on the outside. They may be very friendly people. They may be easy to like, but all of that's a false image. In reality, they're miserable on the inside. They're miserable because they're in conflict, steady conflict. In reality, they're miserable because their flesh is in conflict with the Holy Spirit of God. What fellowship does darkness have with light? There is no fellowship. So they're at war within themselves. They are miserable because they know they're far from God. They're much further from God than they ever thought they would be. Do you know what the best sleeping pill is? A clear conscience with God. This is how you can sleep like a baby. If you are at peace with God, and you don't drink coffee after 6 o'clock, you will sleep like a baby. But a child of God who is far from God, internally, they're unhappy. They're miserable. They've lost their joy. Church, sin will kill your joy. It'll steal it. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus says, "But I've come that you may have life and have it more abundantly." And because of the sin that you're clinging to in your heart, the Holy Spirit of God is grieved. And you've lost your joy. Let's look at it again, verse 30. "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." Listen, Christian brother or sister, sin will not cause the Holy Spirit to leave. I believe once we're saved, we're always saved. I believe in the eternal security of the believer because it's the Holy Spirit that seals our salvation. He's the one that keeps us saved. I'm glad my salvation depends on Him instead of me, or I'd be in deep trouble. But when I gave my heart to Jesus Christ, He sealed me. He lives in me, and He seals me, and He will never leave. So sin in my life will not cause Him to leave, but it will cause Him to grieve. Let me say that again. He will not leave because of our sin, but he will grieve because of our sin. The Holy Spirit seals us. We're covered by the blood. He keeps us saved. Praise the Lord. But as a saved person, sealed by the Holy Spirit, as the temple of God with the Holy Spirit living in our life, if we harbor sin in our life, if we guard sin, if we protect sin in our life, if it's unconfessed sin, then the Holy Spirit will not leave, but he will grieve. The Holy Spirit is the indwelling Spirit, the guiding Spirit, the guarding Spirit, but he's also the grieving Spirit if we let sin just stay in our life and we do nothing about it. So let me ask you, how you doing? How are you doing? Are you okay? How do you feel? Do you feel joy in your life? Or is there something going on inside? Are you at conflict? Is there conflict in your heart? Is there some internal issue, some internal battle? What's the source? Have you got some regret going on? What's the source of that regret, those issues, those battles? Have you allowed sin to take hold of you and you're following that sin instead of the influence of the Holy Spirit? If that is you, it's time to get your heart cleaned and ready. It's time to get that out of your life. It's time to let go of that grief you're causing the Lord. He wants to fill you with joy. Joy unspeakable that makes you want to shout from the rooftop, I was a sinner. Bless God, I'm saved. He cleansed me. Don't you remember that joy when you got saved? What's happened to that? You've harbored sin in your life, and now the Holy Spirit is grieving inside of you. If that is you, we want to do some house cleaning today. We're going to identify just exactly what persons are they that grieve the Holy Spirit. Paul is going to tell us in Ephesians chapter 4. He's going to identify three kinds of people that grieve the Spirit. So as we identify them, check to see if any of these are you. Paul also identifies who they are, those who do this. Here are the three. We're going to take a look at them, but Corey will put these three. These are the three that grieve the Holy Spirit. The uncommitted, the unsubmitted, and the unrepented. These will cause the Holy Spirit to be sad in our heart, and it will steal our joy. Now remember, Paul's writing to Christians, so our focus today is on Christians, but it's primarily on carnal Christians, sinful Christians, those who are following sin instead of the Savior. And so Paul identifies three Christians that grieve God. We're going to look at them. Number one, the uncommitted grieve the Holy Spirit. Let's read chapter 4. Chapter 4 identifies all three of these for us. Let's begin reading in verse 17. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who is being past feeling, given themselves over to lewdness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. But you have not so learned Christ. If indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct, that you put off the old man, which grows corrupt according to deceitful lust, and instead be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, putting away, let each one of you speak, put away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor. For we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give to him who is in need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but instead what is good for necessary edification. That means building up and encouraging, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Now, Paul is warning us not to live as we used to live before we got saved. He's telling us we should not live like that anymore, that we should be different. He gives us these admonitions. He says, no longer walk as the Gentiles walk. Put off your former conduct. Put off the old man with his deceitful lust, but instead put on the new man, which was created by God for righteousness and holiness. Therefore, put away lying. Speak not word or talk. Put away bitterness, wrath, clamor, evil speaking, and all malice. Paul is reminding us that when we get saved, we get different. He changes our lives. Jesus saves us. The Holy Spirit seals us. And then we are transformed from our old way of life. We do not become sinless, but we do sin less. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is passed away. Behold, all things become new. We come to Jesus just as I am, but we leave differently. We leave renewed and recreated and reborn. Paul is saying that our walk with Christ is a walk of genuine commitment. It's not easy, but it's worth it. Only he who is truly committed, only he will experience the fullness of the joy of the Spirit in their life. Therefore, do not grieve the Spirit by living an uncommitted life. Do not grieve the Spirit by continuing to walk in your old ways. When we're unchanged, when we're uncommitted, we grieve God. Church, Jesus paid it all on the cross. It cost him everything. He left heaven for that cross for us. And just as it cost him, it cost us too. Commitment cost. Narrow is the gate and difficult is the way that leads to eternal life. That's why only a few find it. Newsflash, when we get saved, we get different. We're to look different, we're to act different, we're to think different, we're to be different. So different that others notice that in our life. That's why Jesus said these words, be on the screen, Matthew chapter 5. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and therefore glorify God the Father in heaven. No matter how old or how young you are when you get saved, you could be 8 or 80, it should show up in your life. As a matter of fact, Jesus said he would rather you, it's so important that you live a changed life. It is so important that you be different that he said he would rather you be hot or cold instead of lukewarm. He says, if you're lukewarm, Revelation chapter 3 says, so then, because you're neither hot nor cold, but lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. You don't even taste good to God. Are you saved? Do you remember when you got saved? Was there change in your life? How were you before you met the Lord? How are you after you've met the Lord? Have you become a little slack? Are you less committed today than you once were? Are you grieving the Holy Spirit? He won't leave, but he will grieve. Is the Holy Spirit of God happy living in you? Take up your cross and follow him. Commitment costs. The uncommitted grieve the Holy Spirit. Number two, the unsubmitted grieve the Holy Spirit. Now, technically, unsubmit is not a word, so you English teachers, cut me some slack, all right? Unsubmit is not a word, but the meaning is real. The meaning of it is very appropriate for today. Paul identifies for us the unsubmitted. Let's read verse 31. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor... You know what clamor is? I had to look it up. You know what it is? It's shouting, hollering, hateful stuff. I think about the mobs and the people hollering at the police and things like that. Evil speaking. Put all that away from you with all malice and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Church, Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. Jesus is the epitome of humility. He humbled himself for us. Therefore, one of the greatest public characteristics of a saved person is that they are humble to all other people. We submit our life to others. We're to love as others as Christ loves us, and we put others ahead of ourselves. We submit our life to the good of others. We put their desires ahead of our desires. This is our role as a Christian. Paul says here, put away all bitterness and wrath towards others. Put away anger, clamor, evil speaking towards others. Be kind to one another, forgiving one another, even as Christ has forgiven you. Listen, church, how we treat people is a big deal to God. It's important to the Lord. As a matter of fact, we're going to stand before God one day. The Bible says it's appointed for man to die once, and after this to judgment. You will stand before God in judgment. And one of the things that he's going to judge you over particularly was, how did you treat other people? Were you a nice person? Did people feel encouraged, happier, better from just being around you? Were you identified as someone who was quick to say, I'm sorry, I was wrong? Were you one who forgave others quickly? Or were you a resentful person, a person who holds grudges? Are you difficult to be around? Do you always find fault in others and somehow you don't see any fault in your own life? Were you self-centered and unsubmissive to others? Do you see the world only from your eyes and your perspective? We're commanded to live a life of submission. We are to submit to God Almighty. We are to submit to one another. Jesus said, if someone slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other cheek to him also. Jesus said, if someone compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. We should outdo for others what they do for us. It should be a contest for us to outdo the other person. God will judge us one day, and he will judge us on how we treated other people. Because that, we talked about influence this morning in Sunday school. We are a people of influence. The name of Christ is on the line. We're called Christian. And so how we treat others is a reflection to him. And when we are not nice, it grieves the Holy Spirit. The unsubmitted grieve the Holy Spirit. The uncommitted, the unsubmitted, and finally, number three, the unrepented grieve the Holy Spirit. The unrepented will always grieve the Holy Spirit. Let's read verse 26 and 27. Be angry, but do not sin. In other words, be angry about the right stuff. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor do not give place to the devil. Okay, here's the message. That we are not to let unrepented sin dwell in our life, because if we do, we will be giving a place to the devil. When we have unrepented sin in our life, it gives the devil a permanent foothold into our life. And if he gets a foothold, he will put you into bondage. Unrepented sin always gives a place to the devil. And unrepented sin always grieves the Holy Spirit. Church, unrepented sin makes us look dirty in God's eyes. He has washed us. He has cleansed us. He has renewed us. He's making us into the image of his son. But when we have unrepented sin in our life, we're no longer beautiful to God. We are repulsive to God. Now, God knows we'll never be sinless. As long as we live in our human flesh, we'll always have sinful nature. As long as we are in our sinful nature, we'll always sin. But just because we continue to sin as a Christian, we don't want to anymore. He changes our want to. Our attitude towards sin is different now. We don't want to. But when we do, we know it's wrong and we confess it to God. When we don't confess it, let me say it this way. We don't confess our sins to God to let Him know that we've sinned. He already knows that we sinned, right? He knows everything. God knows every sin before we even say it or do it. But when we confess it to Him, a sin that He already knows about, He will forgive us and forget it. He will forgive and forget. But when we do not confess it, we become smelly and disgusting, a stench to God. I mean, just think about it. The Bible says that our good deeds are as filthy rags in the sight of good and sight of God. Our good deeds are as filthy rags. Can you imagine what our sinful deeds are like? It smells like cheese to God, is what it smells like. Our sin saddens Him. Anytime we sin, it saddens God. But when we don't repent of it, it grieves God. It breaks His heart. His Son died so that all you have to do is confess it. Just agree with Him. And when we won't do that, it grieves Him. That's why if we confess our sins, He's so quick and faithful and just to forgive us. He's wanting to forgive us. He's waiting to forgive us. Just ask Him to forgive you, to cleanse you, and to help you. He wants to. But if we don't, He won't even hear our prayers. The psalmist says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Unrepented sin grieves the Holy Spirit. Okay, church, who's the most miserable person in the world? It's the carnal Christian. It's the sinful Christian. It's the Christian that's been saved. He knows what sin is, but he's miserable because he's allowed it to take root in his life, and he won't do anything about it. Who are the ones that grieve the Holy Spirit? Well, it's the uncommitted. They don't live a changed life. It's the unsubmitted. It's the unrepented. What about you? Are you grieving the Holy Spirit? Are you unhappy? Do you just feel this remorse and this regret and you're struggling over and over and over? Confess it. Commit to Him that you want His purity in your life, His righteousness. Say, Lord, I know you live in my heart, and I'm going to surrender to your influence from here on out. And God, when I'm tempted to do wrong, would you speak to me loudly so that I can follow your voice to safety? Cleanse me, O Lord. Help me, O God. I don't want to be uncommitted. I don't want to be unsubmitted. And I don't want to be unrepented. Fill me with the fullness of the Spirit in my life. But if you're not saved, you can't say any of those things. Because if you're not saved, the Holy Spirit of God is not living in you. You're not the temple of God. You're headed to hell if you're not saved. But did you know, lost on the way to hell, you are still grieving the Holy Spirit? You know how you're grieving Him? Because He's inviting you to get saved. And you keep putting Him off. You keep making excuses. I don't want to walk down front. I need to get my life straightened up first. All this stuff, that's lies of the devil. Don't grieve Him. He's inviting you. And He sent me to tell you that He's inviting you to choose Christ. To choose Jesus before it's too late. I'm going to invite you to come forward this morning and do just that. To ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. We had a beautiful young lady come forward last week. This week, it's your turn. It's your turn. Don't leave here without knowing for sure. And if you are saved, don't be that carnal Christian. You're miserable. He can put joy in your life, man. He'll change your life. You believe that? He will. Stand with me. Brother Stephen and Wendy's going to come.